It's been a bit of a trip down memory lane for me recently, as I've been going back to refresh my memory about all the allegedly game-changing sustainable technologies that we've covered on the channel over the last 6 years or so. Despite the truly cringeworthy experience, for me anyway, of having to watch an ever-growing selection of my own previous videos, I've nevertheless found it to be a necessary chore as part of my research for our 2024 Green Tech Review series, partly to make sure I don't completely contradict something that I may have confidently proclaimed in the past, but also, if I'm honest, to have a quick look in the old comments section to see if anyone's pointed out any glaringly moronic errors that I may have made in the original presentations, which, annoyingly enough, has happened on more than one occasion. And it was while I was carrying out that due diligence on a 2020 video about green steel that I spotted this little exchange. It started very well with some positive feedback about my coverage of a Swedish green steel initiative called HYBRIT. Then it all went a bit south when another sharp-witted viewer poured a bit of real-world cold water onto the Scandinavian decarbonisation dream. And in fairness to Nick Techie 55, they're quite right, aren't they? Just as with everything else in our effort to combat climate change and move to a more sustainable world, you won't get far working in splendid isolation if the rest of the world decides it doesn't want to join in, will you? So as we hurtle into 2024, has low carbon green steel actually made any headway? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Regular viewers will have seen my efforts at animating and explaining how steelmaking works on more than one occasion by now in previous videos. But for anyone not conversant with the process, here's a little potted summary. Iron ore is what we dig out of the ground, and it's oxidised because that's what happens. We don't want the oxygen, we just want the iron. So we chuck it in with a load of coking coal and heat everything up to about 1600 degrees or so, at which point the oxygen decides it will be happier with carbon after all, and leaves the iron to pursue a new life either as carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide. The iron that comes out of the blast furnace then goes into something called a basic oxygen furnace, where high pressure air reacts with the hot metal to achieve precisely the right carbon content to make it into steel. That conventional method of production, including the initial creation of the coking coal, results in the emission of well over 2 tonnes of carbon dioxide for every tonne of steel produced. And that's the problem in a nutshell. It means that the global steel industry currently accounts for more than 7% of total human-induced greenhouse gas emissions. The industry is not going to capture that carbon in any kind of economical or practical way at any point in the near future, for reasons that we've looked at several times on this channel, and that you can find out for yourself by going to your favourite search engine and typing in the words "why carbon capture is stupid." So in an ideal world, we want to find something other than coking coal to persuade iron to give up its oxygen, and we probably also want to use electricity instead of fossil fuels to provide all the heat for the various processes. And that's where the HYBRIT project that I mentioned earlier comes into play. The theory is that you make green hydrogen from electrolysis of water and you use it to replace the coking coal in the reduction process. Hydrogen reacts with iron oxide at about 800 degrees Celsius, so already you're saving energy in the heating process, and that reaction produces something called sponge iron, with the only byproduct being water, which can be recycled back into the hydrogen electrolyzer. Sponge iron can then be directly processed in an electric arc furnace, along with a bunch of scrap steel for recycling, and a small amount of carbon as a balancing additive, and lime to remove the final few bits of impurity. There's no need to go through the blast furnace or basic oxygen furnace stages. So new usable steel comes out of the electric furnace, and the whole process results in something like a 97% reduction in carbon dioxide emissions. It's not difficult to see the attraction of the process, is it? Both for steel makers and for steel consumers. The first HYBRIT production facility was completed in 2020, funded by a 50 million euro grant from the Swedish government, plus another 100 million or so of investment from Swedish steelmakers SSAB, the Swedish utility Vattenfall, and a mining company called LKAB. When we last took a look at the project back in 2021, SSAB had just shipped the first consignment of HYBRIT green steel to Volvo, who used it to produce the world's first ever vehicle made with hydrogen-based green steel, a fully electric, fully autonomous dumper truck designed for use in mining and quarrying. So what's been going on since then? Well, in 2023, SSAB and Vattenfall signed a letter of intent that'll see the Swedish power giant beginning pilot projects in 2024 using green steel for infrastructure stuff like pylons and hydroelectric dams and grid stations and elements for onshore and offshore wind turbines. And the two firms have set their back office boffins to work crunching the numbers to provide accurate life cycle assessment figures throughout the entire value chain. They apparently haven't quite got to the stage of pressing the equals button on the calculator yet, but we're assured those figures will be available very soon. Which is just as well for them, because other European startups are also vying for a piece of the green steel action, including the SALCOS project, backed by the German steelmaker Salzgitter. SALCOS essentially employs the same hydrogen reduction technology as HYBRIT, and claims to be on track to achieve a 95% reduction in CO2 emissions. Then there's Balstr, established in Norway in 2021. They're also going after green hydrogen, and they reckon once they get up and running, they'll be churning out some 2.5 million tonnes of what they describe as cost-competitive, ultra-low CO2 steel with around 90% lower scope 1 to 3 emissions than conventional steel production. They haven't produced anything yet, though, as far as I can tell, and nor has the SALCOS project for that matter. And to be honest, it's not at all clear when either of these two initiatives will actually come through. So I won't hold my breath. An arguably rather more bankable prospect, though, is yet another Swedish outfit by the name of H2 Green Steel, or H2G for short, which appears to be bubbling up as the main competitor to SSAB's HYBRIT program. In 2022, they teamed up with a US firm called Midrex, a world leader in direct reduction of iron using methane gas instead of coking coal. H2G will take that know-how and essentially swap out the methane for green hydrogen at a brand new state-of-the-art production facility in the northern Swedish town of Boden, where they will have access to an abundant local supply of hydropower to run their electrolyzers. The company aims to have the plant up and running by 2025, initially producing 2.5 million tonnes of steel per year, and then 5 million tonnes when it reaches full capacity. Commercial partners include Mercedes-Benz and Cargill, and even Volvo has decided to add H2G to its list of green steel suppliers, with a 2023 deal that'll see H2G's Boden plant supplying green steel to the entire Volvo group by mid-2026. H2G say that green steel produced via the hydrogen direct reduction process is currently between 20 and 30% more expensive than steel made in the traditional way. You might think that would be an immediate deal breaker, wouldn't you? But the thing is, global steel producers and consumers are coming under enormous commercial, political and public pressure to demonstrate their willingness to contribute towards reducing the massive impact that steelmaking is having on the climate and environment. So there is a growing acceptance among many companies that the premium for low carbon steel may be a price worth paying in order to keep them in everybody's good books. Another US firm by the name of Boston Metal is coming at the Green Steel Challenge from a slightly different angle. You may have already seen the brilliant video tour of their factory that Rosie Barnes recently posted on the Engineering with Rosie channel. But as a very brief summary, Boston Metal has developed an electrochemical process called molten oxide electrolysis, which breaks iron ore down in a sort of giant battery-like cell and apparently does away with all the carbon-heavy stages of steel production. The company seems to have attracted a great deal of backing from some very well-known names in the industry, but the technology is not yet at fully proven commercial scale, so it's one that I'll make a note to come back to in a later video. Anyway, encouraging updates from both sides of the pond, I think you'll agree. We all know what the elephant in the room is though, don't we? If you're not sure what I'm talking about, then let me help you a little by showing you this pie chart based on data from worldsteel.org. Yes, that's right folks, you're not misreading the graphic. China does indeed produce more steel than the rest of the world put together. So are there any signs that the world's industrial workhorse is embracing the brave new world of fossil-free steel? Well, sort of, I suppose. According to a 2022 analysis by S&P Global, China is on course to have more than 8 million metric tons of low or zero carbon direct reduction steelmaking capacity by 2025, driven predominantly by the world's first and third largest steelmakers, the Baowu Group and Hebei Iron and Steel. Baowu's subsidiary, Biosteel, is aiming to have as much as 90% of its direct reduction processes driven by hydrogen instead of methane gas by 2030. Trouble is, direct reduction represents a tiny percentage of their overall steelmaking operation. The company churned out 115 million tonnes of the stuff in 2020, and more than 93% of that was produced via the blast furnace converter route. And it's a similar story for the rest of the Chinese steelmaking industry. So while they're busy completely upending yet another of their enormous industrial sectors, they will most likely have to rely on carbon capture and storage to keep them on track for their 2060 net zero target. Super. It is a bloody big nut to crack though, this one. The highly respected industry consultancy Wood Mackenzie recently suggested it would require something like $1.4 trillion to achieve a globally decarbonised steelmaking sector by 2050. And according to Global Energy Monitor, a lot of conventional coal-based steelmaking today is still heavily subsidised in many countries around the world. If green steel is to stand any chance of making a dent, then those subsidies will need to disappear very quickly and be redirected into the new technology. But if that can be somehow achieved, and if the world ever gets itself organised onto a properly internationally agreed and aggressively prohibitive carbon price, alongside the appropriate financial protection mechanisms to ensure it's not the poorest and most vulnerable in our societies that get clobbered as a result, then, well, you never know. No doubt you're keen to express an opinion on those sorts of lofty, lefty ideals, or maybe you've got some direct experience in green steel production and you can share some knowledge with us all. Whatever your views or news, the place to leave them, as always, is in the comments section below. Before I go, just a very quick note to let you know that I'll be hosting discussion panels on each of the 3 days of the upcoming Everything Electric Live event in London this Easter, organised by our friends over at the Fully Charged channel. Yeah, I've been promoted! And when I'm not on stage, I'll be mooching about having a look at the astonishing array of exhibitors and new vehicles that you can only get to see at the world's number one home energy and electric vehicle show. If you fancy coming along to say hello, then you can get 20% off your tickets using the discount code on the screen, exclusively for viewers of the Just Have a Think channel. Follow the link on screen or in the description section below. See you there. As always though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.